Welcome back to Lake Placid in upstate New York. A beautiful white wintry scene. There is the home of the Miracle on Ice, right down in the center of the village itself. And out on Mount Van Hovenberg, just by the start area, you can see the athletes up ready for the start of run two, the deciding run of the opening women's bobsleigh World Cup race of the season. And fantastic track conditions despite the hurricane coming through here 10 days or so ago. Tony Carlino, the track chief here, and his crew have been working all the hours that God sends to make sure that this track was in fine form for the opening of the World Cup season. I'm Martin Heyman, alongside me, John Morgan. And John, this track in as good a state as it was for the World Championships in February.
Pretty quick times in the first run. Jamie Grubel, Brakeman Evans have the track start record. That's wrong, but they had a great first run start also. The conditions here, cliffside, the up part of this track, you have to be very quiet with your steering into White Face Curve. It's named after one of the old curves on the old track, which is right adjacent to here. And this is where the sled really starts to motor. You're approaching 70 miles an hour when you hit the Devil's Highway, and that is a description of what it is for the drivers. Shady, you want to exit with a slingshot effect on the bottom part of the track, three-quarter combination. Everybody's got to have one of these on their tracks. And then Benham's Bend, it still drops off into the chicane. It's not straight through here, pretty tricky. Then a big, sharp left, 4.5 G's of force, the heart. A couple more quick transitions into the bottom finish curve. And then they go uphill. And you can still make some mistakes right here at the finish line as you go uphill. And this is quite a challenge for the first World Cup of the year, I can tell you that, Martin.
Well, it's got a reputation, always has had, Lake Placid, of being a difficult track, one that drivers just a little bit cautious about, but you can't take any caution onto the track. They've all had a first run. They've got their nerves out of the way. It's a sunny day. Air temperature's risen now above freezing, but the ice is being kept artificially low, minus 3.5 degrees. The control steel, which the other runners are measured against in the top, you can see the ambient air temperature plus 8 degrees. Well, we've had the first of our two heats here. All 16 sleds came safely down the track. And in the first run, you're looking here at Elena Myers of USA. New rookie brakewoman, Tiana Madison. They got a great start. We only need to give Alana half a sniff of a great start, and she is right in there. She's third after the first heat, and she is our top US sled. Five different nations in the top five. In second spot, perhaps a surprise, Christina Hengster with Inge Bersen behind her. The young Austrian really coming on strong, John Morgan.
Very surprised with her driving down this track. She has really been coming on. Last year was her breakout season, and she's making a statement for herself today. And the Austrians, she's been the only Austrian hope for women's bobsledding since the implementation of women's bob in 1998.
So the junior world champion lies second. Last year's world champion has the lead, Kaylee Humphreys. Last time she was on this track, she claimed gold. But Jennifer Cecchetti was her brakewoman then. She's got a rookie now, Chelsea Valois. Their first day together in the job, and they lead the race.
Yeah, she led the race, but she hit everything in sight all the way down. A great start time, and boy, it was a rough ride down, but sometimes rough is fast.
Well, that case it was, and she can go quicker because she can tidy it up. She leads by 12 hundredths, top three covered by 17. Sandra Kyrias is the top German in fourth, ahead of former world champion Paula Walker, who claimed her junior title on this track a couple of seasons ago. It's a tight top five, and there could still be plenty of changes down the order. This track is very fast and very difficult for the rookies to really get their head around, John. We could see a lot of changes going on here, and for the gold medal as well as everything else.
Well, again, it's six or seven deep, this field. I'm very impressed. The Hengster, we talked about Paula Walker in the first heat. She was very impressive. And here's they're going to go worst to first, is the expression. There's the first 10 sleds that we're going to see. Schneiderheinz down there, very surprised that her and Martini are in those positions. We used to talk about the Germans would always have two sleds in the top three. Now, there's a German that's in fourth.
Okay, here we go. Attention, clear the track. The track is now
I'm very impressed. Women's bobsled, the drivers, the athleticism of the drivers.
Start number one for the forerunner.
Start times used to be all dominated by the Germans. I don't think that's the case anymore.
Well, German women have won every World Cup race, we believe, held at this track. And they may not do that now. This could be the end of a big winning streak for them in Lake Placid. 16 sleds from 9 nations. Which one is going to end up on top of the track? On form, you would think the world champion from February has got to have the best advantage. She is leading, and she can find more speed by tidying up what was a really scrappy first run. So the good money should be on Kaylee Humphreys. But in this sport, you can't always go with the odds.
Sled specs almost exactly the same as the men, except for the weight. It's about 50 pounds lighter. But, you know, they try and standardize the sleds. In fact, there's been a lot of rule changes that have to be implemented over the summer for this year. And the FIBT Material Commission has done a lot of sled checks. Everybody's gone through sled checks. And, again, they're trying to standardize and equalize up the sport. And we think back to the 1984 Olympics, the advantage that the East Germans had with the split axles. And that day is gone. These sleds are pretty much standard, pretty much the same. But well, of course, there is some black magic still out there.
Well, that's true. But like auto racing, if you want to go race in the Sprint Cup, your car goes through tech before it goes onto the track. And that means that you have less problems with disqualifications after the race.
Decent crowd on hand. You know, it's a Friday. A lot of school kids out here. Lake Placid does a great job always bringing out young kids to the track. And now Van Hovenberg, a little snow up here. Elevation here about 1,700 feet above sea level. And we didn't get any of that northeastern storm that everybody got down in New York. And, you know, the hurricane, we had a little bit of high winds up here. But I think the Adirondacks was saved.
Yeah, dodged that bullet pretty successfully. And as a result, the track in fine condition. This is the first of a three-race North American swing. Of course, a week from today, we'll be racing on the track at Park City, Utah, the venue for the 2002 Winter Games. And then we head to Whistler, the venue for the 2010 Games. We do have a track hold at the moment. We're expecting to have had our first sled on the ice. But we now have a one-minute warning at the top. Katerina Kostromina, the Russian rookie, will be the first off the hill. She was 16th out of the start shed on her World Cup debut and set the 16th fastest time. But she was some way away from anything approaching a top 10 finish. Of course, the Russians looking towards Sochi in 2014, and they are trying to bring in new crews.
Our first athletes will be coming up. Of course, you see the DNS. There's no World Cup points. This is their World Cup debut in the World Cup last year.
Getting ready to get the second heat of the season underway here in Lake Placid. The sled laid on its side so the runners don't get any colder than is necessary. The colder they are compared to the ice, the more friction they will generate. We're getting ready for Ekaterina Kostromina to continue her World Cup debut weekend. Natalia Kalashnik behind her has raced in World Cup breaking for Russians before. This young hopeful from Bratsk, just 25 years old.
Yeah, but I was very disappointed in the first run.
Come on.
5.91 start, the worst start of the 16 sleds in the field, and very surprised at that. If the Russians are going to build a program, you want to build a program with athletes in the front seat who can push the sled. And the 5.91 start is going to just give her no chance to break into that top 10 to be that far off at the start.
Start clock counting down from 30 seconds, top right of your screen. They must break the start beam before it gets to zero. They are underway. 5.91 seconds, their first start. Fast starts are down into 5.4s. 5.99, not even as quick as their first getaway.
We'll see starts in the 50s, and we talk about this, the importance of the start. It's a multiplier effect. If you're 300s ahead at the start, you'll be 900s ahead at the bottom, all things being equal.
Through the first two or three corners, really important not to lose the vital speed that you've got on board, whatever it is, good, bad, or indifferent. A twitch or a rub on the wall can cost you so much time. Kostromina has not raced on this track before, John, so she's had half a dozen runs.
At the most, she probably had some early training on it earlier in the week, and then the three official practice runs, big skid there, the chicane, it's a little wild. She's still got a little last chink curve here. Look at that transition. 18 18, 19, that's pretty dangerous down there if you get behind, and she was behind.
Well, 120.7 through the chicane, not as quick as she was before, but it's still 75 miles an hour on this almost out of control missile. So yeah, it can be very dangerous if they get it wrong.
Well, she got a chance of getting it wrong there on the exit of chicane. Shady, that's a pretty good line. Now you dive out of there, I said, with a slingshot effect. That gives you momentum on the bottom part of the track. Look at the runners. Now look at the runner tips here. Now the sled gets away. Now watch her try and drive away. She's coming over to the left side. See that? She tried to drive away from the wall, the back end skid. Now watch the sled change direction. Look at the nose of it drive up high. Now she's got to steer it off. That old thing about friction, the more you steer, the slower you go.
Well, again, indication she didn't know really where she was going. She was driving on what she saw, not on what she knew to be the case. 15th after the first heat, Australia's Astrid Radjanovic. She's married to Serbian slider Vuk and her British brakewoman, Fiona Harrison, from Barnsley in Yorkshire. Well, now they are just 600s behind the sled in front of them.
You know, we talked about it the first run. You know, when they fill out the application of who's your trainer, me. Who's your coach, me. You know, who's your mechanic, me. This poor girl has to do everything herself. And she's a good driver. Asked her about equipment. She said, my equipment's a little suspect compared to the rest of the sleds in the field. I'm going to do better, she said, in Europe. But here she's one-man band. Give her credit, though. She's a pretty persistent athlete.
Letting the sled ride as long as she can on the corners, trying to carry that speed.
Saw the G-forces bang on that brake, but in the back of the sled is buried in there. Come up to Benham's bend. Now the chicane, look at the runner tip. Does she try and drive away from the wall? Big hit, she lets it go. Speed in the left, 121.4, about 73 miles an hour.
Just a whisker slower than the first heat. It looks like the track may not be quite as quick.
First run, 58.12, and this run, 58.54, so half second slower than the first run. She's the leader over the Russian girls, but there's 14 sleds yet to come.
Again, you can hear the kids in the finishing area cheering on all the athletes. Not quite the size that you might expect in the weekend. Of course, it is Friday, so most people still working hard for a living. These athletes are doing here as well, being helped out by the German coaches.
Coming up next, about 1 o'clock.
A clean run from Astrid.
Busy day for us here, a busy day tomorrow. We've got the four-man bobsled getting underway.
Look at the runner tips, top of the track. Clean lines into Shady. Look at that. She goes across the Lake Placid sign. If you're above that, it's too high.
Start one for Anastasia.
Bang off the wall, hard hit, but she didn't steer away from that. And there's a...
That's Astrid on the left and Fiona Harrison on the right. As we get back to the top of the track, the third of our starters, Anastasia Tambrov-Sava. Those are the handles the drivers use to steer this sled. Not
little
like D-rings. A steering wheel in
little
the old
D-rings.
Days.
D-rings. It's a technology that's been molded in time. It's been with the bobsledders for, you know, way before my time. Although the American athletes back in the day, my father and... 50s and 60s and used to have steering wheels. About mid-60s when the Americans stopped using steering wheels and went into the ropes. It's not the guy who drives the most that wins, it's the guy or girl who drives the least.
Yeah, so the steering effect is kind of like a soapbox derby cart, right? Yeah. You just pull right to go right and left to go left. It's a little bit more sophisticated than most soapboxes, though. Just squeezed back into the lead ahead of Astrid Radjanovic. Didn't have the greatest start, Tambrov-Sava.
She's pulling ahead a little bit. You know, she was 400s ahead at the end of the first run over the Australian sled at the bottom. Now it's up to 11. Now, Anastasia, you know, we expect her. She's got a lot of experience. We expect her to start to improve as you get towards Sochi. She's going to have 300 more trips down that track than any other foreign competitor when the Olympics come. So this is one of the Russian hopes for the medals. But got a start time issue, 58.22. That's a much better run on the second run. She's only 1,600ths apart from her first run.
Well, she didn't have the greatest start. The Aussies had a better start, and that's a crew that's never pushed together before this week.
The Russians have the two worst starts of three sleds in the field, and I'm very surprised at that. Look at the heads here.
Nate O'Brien.
Watch the on and off the transition, on and off the curve. Look at that little pressure point. You see that where her head snapped like that? And that's energy and motion in the sled. You know, you're going left to right. When your head's going back and forth, that means the sled's movement is going back and forth. And dealing with hundreds of seconds, it's not what you want to do. Everything you want to have go forward.
Anastasia Tambolseva of Russia is our leader. 12 to go, 13 sleds to go. In fact, we had a tie for 12th place with our world champion from February, Jen Cacchetti. She was in the back of the Canada one sledder, Kaylee Humphreys. And we believe this is a unique first. Reigning world champions in a two-woman sled racing against each other as drivers. She's got Kate O'Brien on the back of the Canada two sled.
Great shot of the goggles, one of the few in the field with goggles. I think her teammate, Kaylee Humphreys, is the only other athlete in the field with goggles. Everybody else, visors, Cicchetti, great athlete. You know, drove a little bit last year, drove on the America's Cup Tour last year. And, you know, she's had it up in the back seat. Got a world championship out of it last year, and now she's, you know, aspiring to win a medal as a driver.
Well, this is a classic way of building your program, isn't it? It's exactly what happened to Kaylee Humphreys. She was a winner as a brake woman, went into the front seat. Jennifer is doing exactly the same. You divide and multiply.
Hey, a lot of Myers in the United States is coming up. Won a bronze medal. Ooh, right there. But she won a bronze medal in Vancouver. Now she's driving a sled and one of the medal favorites for the Sochi next year because of her great athleticism.
Decent speed, 121.6. That's the quickest we've seen through there in this second heat.
This is a athlete here needs about four or five more races. Good start. She had the sixth best start of the first run. The Russians can only look on and know that they're not the leaders anymore. Canada 2 takes over the lead.
Only 1,500 slower than their first heat, John, so that's very good consistent driving.
You know, we talk about the athleticism of the start.
Stand by.
Look at
so
the
some great tight
probably
racing. We saw this yesterday with the
you have so many steps. I'm going to take 15 steps and get in. It's
as we get a little deeper
in and down. You don't want to see the driver, you don't want to see the brakeman's shoulders anyplace. So let's look. Can we see the brakeman back there bouncing around? Yeah, I can see a little bit of bouncing around. See that? See that brakeman come up a little bit? That's an aerodynamic profile, the big hole in the sled. We talk about the dirty air that goes over the driver, exits in the back of the sled, and anybody involved with physics know that dirty air is not a good flow.
There you saw Jen with a big smile on her face. She has the lead of the race. She was tied in the first heat with Fabienne Meyer of Switzerland. 27-year-old relative rookie Cacchetti. But Fabienne Meyer, a former junior world champion. She's now 31. She's been in World Cup sliding for the last five seasons, so she's got plenty of experience.
There's our leaders. Cicchetti.
New brake woman behind her, Kate O'Brien. Let's see what the Swiss have got.
I think Fabienne Meyer was the most disappointing sled for me in the top 10. I really thought she was going to do better. No speed on the bottom part of the track. 78 start time. You know, wasn't that great in the first run. She was the 11th best start, but she's a good driver. You know, you don't win the Junior World Championship without having some ability. But her sled had no speed at all on the bottom part of the track. And look, she's 1,600 down that, Cicchetti. Because Cicchetti had a much better start. So we're going to have to see that 16 go to 11 or 12 us today. If she stopped the bleed, 16 to 16, you're going to need perfect lines in the bottom to have a chance to catch her. And the speed, probably going to have to be 122 kilometer speed. Have a chance, look at the left. Nope, 121.8. And this is going to be close. This is going to be single digits. I kind of believe the Canadian is going to win this. Down to 12, yeah. She might get it down to 8 or 9, but she's going to drop back at least one spot here. 14, lost a little bit more. Swiss sled with no speed in the bottom. Look at the coaches. They just shake their heads.
And look at the shape of the sled. You won't see anything else like that. This Citius project that was started just after 2006 games by the Swiss. It's a very individual look, and it's all about low wind resistance, cheating the air, trying to get speed around the body.
And look, here's Shady. Now look at the brakeman buried in there. Look at the way they get bounced around. The way you bounce around on that sled is very important, the way you ride. And you can see the head bounce. That's the G-forces. But, you know, a lot of times they set the sled up for that individual. And that's very, very important for that brakeman to be riding very, very comfortably in that sled. If not, it deals with hundreds of seconds of loss.
So a little wry smile from Fabienne as she slips down the order into second place with 11 still to go. And this is Olga Stulneva, new name to conjure with. If we say Olga Fedorova, you might remember the 29-year-old from Ekaterinburg a little better.
Come on,
the first of four or five sleds where we're going to be talking about track and field athletes making the crossover. She won a silver medal at the Athens Games in 4x100 relay for Russia. She was Olga Fedorova then. And of course, over the summer, she threw a curveball and got married on us.
Nadia Sergeyeva, her brakewoman, has the real look of a track and field athlete as well.
573 start. That's 300s, or a little bit slower than their first run. 800 slower. That's not consistency. The good teams will come out and match the starts. 565, maybe a 564.
100th in front of the Canadian leaders.
She has every once in a while good heats. You saw the mistake there, and boy, she's late. Down at Devil's Highway, she almost crashed. She got behind in that three-corner combination above Devil's Highway and recovered now, but lost a lot of speed. Still has a chance if she gets 122-kilometer speed. Doesn't have that, so it's going to be tough. Jennifer Cicchetti could pick off another sled here.
She's moving up towards the fringes of the
top.
Now
the question is she going to fall behind Fabienne Meyer? She might.
Yeah, she's in second place at the moment. Yes,
fourth
just.
Best time. Falls back. The Canadians move up on. Look at the Russians shake their head. A lot of inconsistencies with this young Russian athlete in the front seat. You saw that last year. The athleticism is there, but it's time for her. She's had a couple hundred trips down these tracks. It's time for her to start to produce.
Yep.
Look at the mistake. Watch this. This is up top. Watch her tap here coming in. Boom. Now to the middle of the curve. Now watch how the sled climbs here. Airborne. You know, you're just fighting for survival there. You aren't looking, even thinking about your time. You're just trying to get to the bottom after a mistake like that.
She hauled it off there. That was self-preservation, wasn't it? That was not pretty, but it got the job done.
A lot of instinct takes over in that situation. There's our leaders.
Looking happy, 10 sleds to go. Jennifer Cicchetti leading in her World Cup debut as a driver on this Lake Placid track. She's had a couple of starts before. She leads with 10 to go. Stay with us for lots more action.
December 30th in the 1980 Herb Brooks Arena at the Olympic Center. We've got Stars on Ice, it's pretty special. Kurt Browning's last year, and Dorothy Hamill is going to join the team for this particular tour. 2 minute warning to our next sled. 2 minute warning to our next sled. Also coming up, some great NCAA Division III men's hockey. The Ice Championships coming to Lake Placid in March, so March 15 and 16 in the 1980 Herb Brooks Arena, of course, at the Olympic Center. And you can buy tickets for a few of these things now, but you can also check ticket prices and so on online at www.whitefacelakeplacid.com.
You can also check out the Lake Placid Olympic Sports Complex Facebook and Twitter page. Keep up to date with our athletes as well as the ongoing events here at the track. Once again, it'll be Ismay, Jamie, Kathleen, Anya, Jasmine, Paula, Sandra, Alana, Christina, and Kaylee. Coming up next, those are our top athletes after run number one. Things will start getting very tight here in the middle of the pack and then again at the top of the race. So stick around, cheer on our sliders, and at 4:30 we will have the medal ceremony.
And we'd like to say thanks to the Lake Placid Central School and the Elizabethtown Lewis Central School for participating in the Scholastic Sliding Challenge. They learned about the sport and the nations that these athletes call home. So we'd like to thank all the kids for playing hooky today, coming out to join us.
Welcome back to World Cup start of the season for the women's bobsleigh. Olympic champion talking to Olympic champion. Kelly Humphries on the left, one in Vancouver. Sandra Kyriassis, one in Salt Lake and in Torino. So three Olympic gold medals competing on this track. They are both to come in our remaining 10.
I got to correct you in that. She didn't win the gold medal in Salt Lake. She was second.
She didn't, correct.
Jill Bakken.
She won
oats. There's our leaders now, though.
Okay, here are our race leaders, Jen Cacchetti, the driver, and Kate O'Brien. And 10th after the first heat, Esme Campos, after a year away from the ice, makes her World Cup return for the Netherlands with Judith Wies behind her.
Love talking about the driver, Esme. She's a doctor. And she does a lot of one of the conflicts she always had. She went to the nursing homes and she had to shoot up a lot of people with steroids. And of course, that's a real bad involvement to even be around that stuff. And because they test these athletes on a weekly basis.
A decent start in the first heat, 5.64.
Didn't get in, yeah. Little problem getting in there.
Quarter spikes on the cow, 5.69.
Good start. Again, we talked about she had a breakout season 2 years ago. She won a silver medal at the European Championships and the track in Chisana, the Olympic track. But then she, last year, took the season off. Everybody, what happened, but she's back. She's got skill. And, you know, the Dutch program. You know, they're more famous for that ice skating sport. Oh, yeah. Here at bobsled, men's and women bobsledding it's a big story in Holland. We'll see the men's bobsledders coming up later. They got some good athletes pushing those sleds. Just don't expect that from a country that's below sea level.
Slower through the speed trap at chicane in her first run. She's easing away from Jennifer Cacchetti for 10th place. Good slide from her. That adds 0.2 to her first round advantage. You saw world champion Nicky Minicello, who is coaching the Dutch girls and the Dutch men and their luge program and their skeleton program as well.
Minicello won that world championships here in Lake Placid 2009. Look at the cowling on this sled. This is a Eurotech sled. Everybody's got a little different way for the air to flow. And the Swiss sled's a little bit more narrow. The Bodine American sled's a little bit narrow. The Russian sleds, which are Singer sleds, have a different setup, but there's still height restrictions with restrictions on it, but to each his own. This sled got a little bit more of a rounded look. In fact, the Canadians are using this type of a sled.
Yeah, the Dutch Eurotech company started supplying the Dutch bobsleigh group.
Great lines.
They build race cars, and now, of course, they are supplying the Canadians, and the link there is coach Tom Delahunty. Started coaching the Canadians a couple of seasons ago. Next up, birthday girl Jamie Grubel celebrates her birthday today, so happy birthday to her. She lies firmly in the top 10 with rookie brakewoman Asia Evans behind her.
Another track and field athlete making the crossover. And they had the best start time in the first run. Grubel, a heptathlete herself from Cornell University, coming off a knee injury last year. Steps. Fastest start total in the time with a 5.49 in the first run. Grubel, very powerful driver. The push bar's out, 5.55. I think that push bar might have could have hit the wall. We'll find out right away at this climb. Ooh, bad mistake there, sideways. Watch your hero out of three. You can't see that.
John, when you make a mistake at the start, you've got to immediately forget it and that it ever existed and concentrate on the drive. She's a little wild.
That's a good driver, be able to put it all behind you, because the rest of the track's coming up pretty quick. 27 to 2200s. She's bleeding time back. Going to need to be clean in the chicane. Going to need 121 plus speed.
She was
right
122.4 in the first.
Close.
121.8 is the quickest we've seen.
That should put her in a position to maintain her lead. Jamie Grubel making a coming out party after that knee surgery last year. Major knee surgery. Down 58.03, fastest time of the run. Coaches aren't that happy. You could see that. They aren't high-fiving each other. She made a mistake up top, and up top, you just can't let that sled hit the walls up top where you're trying to accelerate speed, not throw it away. Now watch for the push bar. She gets in. Oh, that left leg didn't get down quick enough. Watch the push bar. Does it hit the wall? Yes, I think that would hit the wall there. You could see her looking over at it. And then she's still got problems here at the top. This is curve three, curve two. Watch her come over here. This is That's a 10-15 hundredths mistake. Now we're looking, can we see the brakeman back there, her rookie brakeman, Aja Evans? She's tucked in there perfectly. Second best speed. The Russian had the best speed. Russian didn't have a very good start time. Jamie Grubel to the leader's box.
She has the lead with eight to go, and definitely the possibility of a bit of advancement if somebody makes a mistake, and that's all too easy. This is Kathleen Martini with Kristen Senkel. Kathleen, now in Germany, three, reflecting her speed in their selection races.
I talked about the Swiss being disappointing in the first run. Martini, very disappointed, driving an FES Berlin sled. Let's see, a little bit different shape than the Eurotech sled we talked about, or the less sled that just came down. There's a tap, that's not good. This is the probably the best driver on the planet, but the start time, six best start times so far of nine sleds down, that's not very good. But she's got magical eyes and hands. She might have been behind it to start 1700s. She needs to be perfect here in the bottom part of this track to overtake Jamie Grubel, which I bet you Jamie Grubel's never beat Kathleen Martini.
She was only 200s quicker.
Big speed, though. Look at the speed. 2 kilometers better than Grubel. Now it's going to get single digits. It's going to be close. Oh, it's 100. This is going to be green numbers. So you can see what a good driver can do in the bottom part of this track. Ducks her head for aerodynamics. Comes. What a. Look at the coach, Christoph Long, and he knew it. Well, that's what you expect, but her start time is so bad.
Yeah.
This is very, very surprised.
She gave away a quarter second at the start.
And that's, you know, usually she gives away 10, 12 hundredths to the best start, but that far behind, maybe she's nursing an injury as we come into the first part of the season, but Martini's going to have a hard time on some of these tracks. She can't do this every time down. She just hit a home run. You can't hit a home run every time you come up to bat when you have a deficient start time. When you got an average start time, you can have a couple singles in there and make it work.
Well, I think perhaps the huge start of Jamie Grubel and Aja Evans really puts that into perspective, but they are the fastest in the field. Kathleen looks relatively happy with that. She dug the fat out of the fire. Can Anja Schneider-Heinze do the same? I mean, two German sleds, seventh and eighth, only one in the top five. That's unusual for such a well-drilled program.
The Germans used to have the best starts across the board. Nobody could touch them. Now the Americans are coming out, Jamie Grubel and Aja Evans with the best start in both runs so far. And this was the best starting team in the world here last year. Schneider-Heinze, there's their rival. Yeah, this is the German leading team here. Mm-hmm. They don't want to even look because they know what Schneider-Heinze is going to beat him by 25 hundredths at the start. But Schneider-Heinze doesn't have the driving ability that Martina has at the bottom. You know, that Martini just came down with a home run. And Schneider-Heinze, I don't think she can hit home runs with her driving skills.
We'll wait and see.
Yet.
She's the German number one. And that's not on past experience. That's on what she did in the selection trials.
So we're going to see a 560 start, which means she's going to be 25 or 30 hundredths at the first clock ahead of Martini. And then we're going to watch that time go down. It's a question of, it's going to be a tenth at the bottom either way. Schneider-Heinze, the gold medalist at the 2006 games as a brakeman. Another example of a brakeman getting up in the front seat. Ooh, she's driving the mistake. She missed a step.
Bertels barely even got into the sled, but she did.
Well, yeah, but that extra step might cost her the next clock. This thing goes to like 14 or 15. That means that start mishap really cost her.
Well, she was 24 hundredths up at the first timing beam.
No,
33 hundredths.
It's going to stop pretty quick. It's going to stop accelerating away. I would say we're probably going to see in the 20s at the next clock. It's coming down a little bit. But this is a lot of time in the bank. She's got to make a major mistake here not to be the leader at the bottom. Down to 27. Yeah, it's a lot of time. Speed, 122, 121, 9. Kilometer down. Look at the runner tips. Big mistake, big skid. She's going to lose 10, 15 hundreds, but I still think she's got so much time because of the start. Look at it.
It's going to be
now
close.
It's going to be down to the 100.
57.98 slide for Kathleen Martini.
56. She hits
10. She goes behind. She was 600s up.
Look at the drive.
She goes behind by 600s.
You know, we said it. You know, she can't hit home runs. Martini just hit the home run. She, in fact, she hit an error there. She got on base maybe by an error because She just made a major mistake trying to steer away in the chicane. And that cost her all the time.
Outside her window, her brake woman is in tears. And here's why. She has to haul on the sled to get herself in. Yeah, and that's pulling it backwards when she wants to be pushing it forwards.
Wow. So there's that first mistake. But the real crucial mistake's here. Watch the runner tips here. She doesn't trust. She's coming good. She taps on that one side. Now watch her try to steer away. Look at the runner's view. She panicked. Let it go. Look at the coach. I think we know what he was, what he was saying.
Well, there's Anya.
And there's Rennie Spies, another one of them Hall of Fame drivers from the German Federation.
They're already commiserating with Franziska Bertels because everybody makes mistakes. Now then, USA 3 in the top six. We have two US sleds. This is Jasmine Fenlater on the back handles. Lolo Jones
making her debut in the sport of bobsledding, coming from track and field hurdlers. You know, great hurdlers have been involved in bobsledding before. Willie Davenport made the Olympic team in 1980, the 68 Olympic gold medalist in Mexico City. And then, of course, the great Edwin Moses was around for two seasons in 90-91. He was unbelievable. Now Lolo Jones trying to apply her track and field skills here in the sport of bobsledding. Jasmine Fenlater really has been improving as a driver. And I tell you something, her physical look, she has really sculpted herself in the last couple of years. Very focused. Ooh, a little tap there. Big lead. I can't see her throwing this away. This is a good run for the American Jasmine Fenlater. Good speed. Not as good as Martini, but she's got so much time because of the better start. Who's a little time back, but this will be our leader. Great drive down for Fenlater. Look at her duck her head for aerodynamics. Wow. That's impressive.
Well, she beat her rival by nearly 0.2 seconds on that run alone. That's a very
two German sleds. Let me point that out.
Yeah.
She beat two German sleds. And Jasmine's probably only got three or four World Cup races under her belt.
Yeah.
Very impressive performance by the driver. And with her brakeman, Lolo Jones, the Americans have the best two starts so far. Lolo Jones, great way to start her career.
Absolutely. It'll be very interesting to see how these three crews, all the American sleds with a rookie brakewoman, how they develop through the season.
Look at them ducked ahead here for aerodynamics. Hundreds. They're looking for hundreds of seconds. Look at her. She knows.
Yeah.
Jasmine Fenlater. She has sculpted herself into a physical athlete from what we saw three, 4 years ago. And her driving skills. It's Jasmine on the right, Lolo on the left.
Well, you know, they only race 8-10 times a year. The rest of the year, in the gym. Here is Great Britain's Paula Walker, junior world champion on this track in 2011. Jill Cook behind her. And they lie in fifth place. They are definitely within sight of a medal. One good steer to undo a fault from the first heat could put her in the top three.
Very impressive in the first run. Start, sixth best start, 564. The way where things are going, 566, 567 should be the norm here. 565, only 100 off, that's what you want. She was really clean on this track. And I think she's the tallest driver in the competition. Jillian Cook, she's a track and field athlete. The brakeman, she was a world championship brakeman for the British in 2009. A little late there in Devil's Highway. She's only got a 500th lead. Fenlater at the bottom.
She was 800s in front for the first heat.
It's down to two.
Drifting away, and that underlines what a great
122 per lap. No speed, no speed. So she's going to have a
too slow.
Real problem here, matching the American on the bottom part of the track. Now plus six. Can't see her overcoming that deficiency in the bottom here. Ducks her head, 14. So Jasmine Fenlater and Lolo Jones will move up one spot. Can do no worth now than a fifth place. Well, Paula Walker falls down one to sixth.
A lot of these athletes name their sleds. Paula's is called Maximus because he's fast and strong sometimes. A good two runs here to start her World Cup season.
Little tap there on the bottom part. That's why she had no speed. Look at the transition. Right here as you go into Benham's Bend, named Look at her eyes. She's a tall girl. She's got a good aerodynamic profile right there. Speed comparison. Look at this. Martini Walker with the ninth best speed. That little mistake she made in the exit of Shady into the chicanes could be the spot that took away all the speed.
Lolo Jones in the cap and putting on the jacket. Jasmine Fenlater, our leaders. Well, Paula Walker slips to second, guaranteed a top six finish. We have four to go. We still have another US sled. There's Paula Walker for Great Britain. Next up, though, we have the remaining German. No Germans in the top three. And no women's bobsleigh race since the year 2000 has been won by any other than a German athlete on this track.
5.76 start in the first run, 11th best start time. That's suspect. You know, this, we told the story in the first run. Kyriassis, the most dominant driver in the history of the sport in the last 10 years. She used to win the first 4 or 5 years with her start times. Now she has to win with her driving abilities. And she did that in the first run. She'll be way behind the American here with this clock coming up. Watch this. We see the 18 clock. It should be probably plus 20 or something. 15. Now, the way she drove with the first run, at 15, might go to 16 or 17 here at Shady, but then she'll attack that time on the bottom part of the track, 14. Stop the bleeding. Now, we see one of the best drivers in the world coming here on the bottom, and the speed's gonna be the key. She's gonna need, oh, doesn't have it. She doesn't get 122 and change here, she has no chance. Good speed, but not the speed the American sled had. Boy, Jasmine Fenlater has never beaten Sandra Kyriassis. This is the most dominant pilot in the last 10 years in the history of this sport. She might get beat here.
She's going down.
She
no
did.
Medals here for the Germans, 58.03. Wow. And in fact, that's only 100th quicker than Paula Walker managed. Jasmine Fenlater came down 57.82, quarter second faster.
Three sleds to go. That guarantees the Americans at least a medal. One of those American sleds is going to medal.
Absolutely.
Boy, shock.
Right.
Look at this. I think we have a dawning of a new era out here. Yeah. This used to be Germany, 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 and whoever else could get up there, but the German sleds.
Well, that streak of German girls only winning World Cup races here, or only German girls winning World Cup races here in women's bobsleigh, is at an end. It cannot now happen. Jasmine Fenlater leads with three to go.
Great lines. Great lines through there.
Number one. Start one.
Wow. Jasmine and Lolo Jones. In with a shot at a World Cup podium in their first race together. And we've got another rookie limbering up at the top of the track, another Olympic athlete getting ready to push off a US sled. Alana Myers is on the front handles of USA One, sporting the colors of Cam Grounds of America. And Tiana Madison is her brake woman. Wow, what a day.
Another track and field athlete coming from a gold medal in London. Now she's pushing USA bobsled to a medal. Great story here. Madison, a sprinter from Tennessee. And we can go back to the 1988 Olympic team. Willie Gall, a Chicago Bears football player and track and field guy. He made the Olympic bobsled team in 88, also competed at the 90 World Championships for the U.S. And boy, the USA athletes here, the start times that they've got. And Myers, a brakeman who won a bronze medal at the 2010 Games, now in the front seat. Bronze medal last year's World Championships here.
2 tenths clear of Jasmine Fenlater, adding to her first round advantage. No, she's not. It's slipping away.
And no speed either. This is going to be close.
Wow.
This is two American sleds head to head here. Down to six, right to the hundredth of a second. Either way.
Wow. Unbelievable drive from Jasmine Fenlater. Puts her into the medals. Look at that. Wow. That's exceptional.
I'll tell you something. I mentioned when Fenlater came down that she had a good run. And that speed she had, I was very impressed with. She seems to be the person emerging as the real talented driver. And now she's got this start time. Two great athletes here. This is what you have to have. You got great athletes in the front seat with these track and field athletes in the back. The Americans are going to be tough.
Well, John, three American sleds in the top four fastest start times. That says its own story.
Yeah, start times. They have had 30 or 40 trips on the track in the last month, which is an advantage. But next week they go to Park City. That's all about a start time out there. Look at the lines here, though. These are really good lines. And there's our celebration at the end. Lolo Jones captures a medal in her first appearance.
What a great recruitment drive.
First time Fenlater's ever beat Alana Myers, too. So there's a little
time in the World Cup medals for Jasmine Fenlater.
Okay.
Two to go. The USA lead in Lake Placid. Now,
big surprise here. This is a team that doesn't start the sled very well.
10th fastest start for Christina Hengster and Inge Wersen of Austria, but can they claim a medal here?
570 start. She's going to need 572 or so to compete here and be perfect. She's going to hit a home run on the bottom of the medal. 575, 500's up. That clock is minus five. The next time we see it, it'll probably be red numbers, plus five, and then she's got to stop the bleeding. That didn't help right there, that tap. And she's got two American sleds to deal with at the bottom for the medal.
She's not responding well to the pressure, John. Couple of early errors, runs off vital speed.
If it's only plus 12 at Shady, she's got a chance. Because she was really magical in the bottom part of the track. There's the plus 12. Now she's going to stop the bleeding. Now she gets down to what, 122 kilometer speed. We're going to see about 75 miles an hour. There's it down to 11. 122.5, 122.2. Probably going to get down into single digits. It's going to be right to the 100. Americans could win two medals here. This is single digit. This is going to be plus three or four. Get both Americans medals.
Well, she's currently in third place.
Look at that.
Both American sleds are on
medal.
The podium.
Look at that. Three sleds separated by 200ths of a second.
Wow.
That's bobsledding
that
at its best.
Great. And
that's
we
unbelievable.
Still have one to go. Top five at the moment, separated by 1,400ths of a second. I don't know how few inches that translates to the speed at the bottom.
We talked about in the first heat how women's bobsledding has improved. It's not just the Germans. Here's an Austrian sled. We've got a British sled in the top six. This is pretty impressive. Here's the mistake. She lost a tenth there. She lost her medal placing right there. And she'll be the first to tell you. Look at her duck her head down there. Look at these lines here. Little tap, doesn't try and steer away from the wall. Decent speed, but not the speed that the American sleds had. A Fenlater especially. Look at the coaches. 100th, that's your fingernail, Martin.
So close.
2 miles, you go, it's your fingernail you're behind. Look at her.
Well, do you know what? That was a great run. But look at these girls. They lead with one to go.
Silver medal.
Only the Olympic champion needs to flake. The world champion on this track in February needs to flake, and they get a rookie win.
Another track and field athlete in the back here making her rookie debut.
Chelsea Valois behind Olympic and world champion Kaylee Humphries. Surely there'll be no stumbling here. 5:56, they get quicker than their first start.
We're going to need some mistake. We saw her at Everton in sight in the first thing. So she made a little tap there. Watch it here. Back. She hit Everton in sight, and she still was the leader at the bottom of the first one. So, which tells me one thing. She has got this sled dialed in where she does not steer it. And to come down this track without steering, you got to be pretty brave.
That was wild. 3,100 up in the
pull
first
away.
Heat. Still only 0.4 up, and the gap is coming down a little.
Pull it away. Not only her comes out, she's back to the field. 122 and change speed, 74 on big speed. She can hit a couple more things. She's going to win. Kaylee Humphries, the Olympic gold medalist, fought off all these new challengers. And she did what she did last year when she won the world championships.
She's
on this track.
Pulling away. It is gold for Kaylee.
Wow. Look at that on the bottom.
57.66 time. And she takes victory as she did in February in the world championships. A new breakwoman, Chelsea Valois, wins her first ever World Cup race. Congratulations to her for being in behind the Olympic and world champion. Certainly gave her a chance to do so. But a great committed drive from Kaylee Humphries. She knew that she was under pressure. She takes the gold medal. But for Jasmine Fenlater and Lolo Jones, well, I watched them in training. They were still conversing after every heat, working out how best for Lolo to ride the sled behind Jazz. And they have taken a silver medal. It's a North American podium. There are your winners. Chelsea Valois on the left, Kaylee Humphries on the right of your shot. Jasmine Fenlater, Lolo Jones take the silver medal. And Alana Myers and Tiana Madison take bronze. But it was gold, gold, gold for Kaylee Humphries. She is our World Cup points leader as she wins race one of the season.
Well, the first run was untidy. She hit pretty much everything, more hits than Elvis. The second, though, was a lot better. She found the speed she needed to accelerate away. Well, there is your race winner. Confirmation of that result. Kaylee Humphries, the victor by 47 hundredths of a second over Jasmine Fenlater. And what a second drive for Jazz. Came from sixth to second for her first World Cup silver medal in Lake Placid. Alana Myers completing the podium with bronze. Christina Hengster slipping to fourth. Great Britain's Paula Walker rounding out the top half dozen. Lake Placid, New York State. We're in the Adirondack Mountains at the end of the first Women's Bobsleigh World Cup race of the season. Lots of school kids here watching some fantastic action from our Olympic and world champion, Kaylee Humphries. She's got a brand new brake woman behind her. Chelsea Valois from Saskatchewan wins gold on her first day at the office. And she powers Kaylee Humphries to two great starts. Canadian gold medalist from the World Championships here in February does everything that you'd expect. Tidies up the mistakes from the first heat. A couple of little errors in heat two, but nothing to write home about. She led after heat one, claimed gold after heat two. Well, let's take a look then at our World Cup rankings. They reflect race one. Kaylee Humphries, the leader from Jasmine Fenlater, a great silver medal performance from her. 6th to 2nd on the second heat to beat out teammate Alana Myers and the rest of the field. With the flower ceremonies, let's catch up now with John.
Okay, flowers. Okay, we got down here for the flower ceremony for the first World Cup competition of the 2012-13 season. What a bobsled race. Three sleds, second, third, and fourth, separated by just a couple hundredths of a second. We'll go over here to Alana Myers. And Tiana, what a start for you. But Alana, bronze medal last year at the World Championships here in Lake Placid again. Were you happy with both runs?
Definitely wasn't happy with my second one. First one was pretty good. Second one wasn't so happy with. But Tiana did a great job pushing us, so I can't complain about that.
What a start for you in bobsledding. How do you describe what just happened to you today?
It's such a thrill. I'm still trying to comprehend. I try to count the curves. I end up counting to 20 like three times because I'm just too excited to focus. But Alana did an amazing job today, and it felt really good to get the hit together.
Well, you were very tucked in the back of that sled. Very nice job aerodynamically. And so go over to the silver medalist and Jasmine and Lolo watching. Did you know your second run was that good?
No, we've just been working on being consistent. This is our home track, so just relaxing and looking up at the clock at the bottom and seeing where we're at. So I knew I had a pretty good run, but I didn't know I'd climb up this many spots, so it's awesome.
Your drive was awesome in the second run. Congratulations, Lola. How do you describe, 1 month later, you're here in bobsled. How do you describe this?
I love it. I mean, I had to rely a lot on Jasmine. She's kind of walking me through it since I'm kind of new at this. So I really appreciate her help because, I mean, I'm sure I'm frustrating her at times because she has to explain everything and time she would spend, like, focusing, she now has to break down for me. But we're doing good together.
Congratulations. What a start. Good for you. Our gold medalist, another rookie brakeman here. You know, I did the commentary, and Kayla, you hit everything in sight all the way down the track, and you hit the whole track, and you were fast.
I didn't hit everything. I tried to not hit everything. There were a few rough spots, I will admit. Yes, it's early season, first race. I plan to get those out of the way now from the driving aspect and keep going.
Well, keep going. I mean, you just hit everything in sight, won the gold medal. Keep it up. Be scary when you get to straight down the track. Ladies, congratulations.
Thank you.
Oh, a little roughing of the passer there, I feel, from John Morgan on Kaylee Humphries. Certainly tidied up the act. When was the last time, Stat Freaks, that we had three rookie brakemen on a World Cup podium? I don't want to know. And I'm thinking Jasmine Fenlater, that's her first World Cup podium as well. Kaylee Humphries is getting used to this now. But I tell you what, the recruitment has really worked in US bobsled. Great starting, great performing from those guys. And that brings us to a conclusion here in Lake Placid for the women. Their next port of call next weekend will be in Salt Lake City. Well, don't forget, we've got more action coming up live this afternoon. 1800 GMT, 1 Eastern. We get going with the two-man.